Assalaamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to part 4. Question about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. We have few questions and then we move on, inshallah. Because there remain some questions and they need answering, but I'm not going to answer them all because it's going to take forever. But why was the messenger taken to Jerusalem and then up to meet up with Allah? Why not meet up with Allah first, then Jerusalem? Who is more important, Allah or Jerusalem? To get out of this question, Ibn Kathir said that the messenger was taken twice to Jerusalem. Mecca to Jerusalem, Jerusalem to the seventh heaven back to Jerusalem, Jerusalem back to Mecca. So that's why. The question number 2, why was a salat given in this heavenly journey and not through the Quran like any other hajj, zakat, fasting, marriage, divorce, wills, and etc.? Of course, needless to say that as-salat was ordered in the Quran in the early days. As soon as the messenger became a messenger, he started salat. Salat was from day one, from minute zero. The messenger never ever wasted 1 hour being a messenger without salat. It's from the go. Which part of the salat was specifically prescribed? Was it the salat itself or just the daily number? Because that is extremely important. Was it just one event, i.e. one trip to Jerusalem and then to the heaven, or more than one? Of course, the text, the hadith contradict each other, and big, usually they contradict about this issue. Did the messenger travel physically, or was it just a dream? This also, there are tons of different hadiths that contradict each other about this. Some of them say physically, some others said no, it was just a dream. From where did Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey start exactly? Again, texts contradict each other about this. And I've already mentioned this in the previous talks, in the early talks. Please do get back to them to hear what I said back then. Why did the companions differ about this topic? If this happened once and the messenger said once, why did they argue with each other? Why did the hadith differ about this event? Why do you have so many different versions? Why didn't the Quran speak about these two incredible journeys? Allah in the Quran spoke to us about how to seek, how to greet each other, how to eat. Can we eat individually and in groups? Allah spoke about that. Allah spoke about less important issues. And he didn't speak about these big issues. Assuming it was the messenger who went to Jerusalem, yeah? What miraculous things did he see there? Because the Quran in Surah Al-Isra, in Surah number 17, the opening of the Surah, Allah states that he has taken a subservient, one of his human, the prophet maybe, and he's taken it from Al-Masjid Al-Haram to the farthest masjid to show him great miracles. But what great miracles did our messenger see in Jerusalem, if any? Of course, there were none. Now, who narrated the events of these Isra and Al-Mi'raj? Because they contradict each other. Of course, there are more questions and a really endless number of questions. But I just want to keep it simple at this one here. I want to say this. As-Salat, as I said, just like Hajj, Ramadan, and any other Islamic rituals, was prescribed while the messenger is on earth. Salat was never ever given to the messenger, not even the number of how many rak'at you pray or how many times you pray a day. All that was revealed to him while on earth. For the messenger never ever quit or left the earth to not to Jerusalem, not to the seventh heaven. My dear sisters and my brothers, oftentimes you hear people, the moment you speak about Al-Isra, they will tell you, oh, it's in the Quran. Where is it? They go to Surah number 17. That is Surah Al-Isra. And the ayah number 1. For your information, this Surah Al-Isra was not known as Surah Al-Isra. It was known as the Surah of Banu Israel, the Surah of the children of Israel. It's only recently when the Quran started being printed that they started calling it Surah Al-Isra to link it to the messenger. But actually it is not. The entire surah talks about the children of Israel. But anyhow, they will tell you, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi. Of course, the English translation, they will say it's glory be to him who carried his subservient in the dark. But the true meaning is, it was the deed of Allah to have carried in the dark, his subservient. Allah did not specify who this subservient was. He just left it like that. And then he said, nightly, from the sacred masjid. You see, Asra in Arabic is to take someone at night, is when somebody travels at night, that's called Asra. So when Allah added Laylan, nightly, it created a great deal of confusion between the sheikhs. Because here Allah says that he carried somebody in the dark by night. It already is dark at night. But anyhow, they say from the sacred masjid, and they say this is Al-Kaaba, to the furthest masjid, and they say the one in Jerusalem, the Aqsa Mosque, whose surrounding we have blessed. This is what Allah says. And then Allah gives us the reason as to why he did this. He says, لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا, so that we show him of our signs. So Allah wanted to take this subservient at night. And what can you see at night? Once you get there, what exactly can you see at night? Especially at that moment there, there were no lights. You see, there is a problem with this ayah. Because Allah then says, for Allah is the one who hears and sees. Allah sees all these things, hears all these things limitlessly. So it's Al-Isra in Surah 17, ayah 1. So, if this prophet, if this person is Prophet Muhammad that Allah has taken to the farthest masjid, Aqsa Masjid, which is in Palestine, what was the signs that Allah showed him? Who had built those signs? You see, there is a huge problem. Because this ayah is not talking about the messenger Muhammad at all. It's not. This surah is speaking about Musa, the person that Allah has taken at night from the Masjid al-Haram to the Masjid al-Aqsa, they say from the sacred masjid to the farthest masjid. It's not Muhammad, but it's Musa. How do we know that? Well, it's simple. At the time of the messenger, when you tell somebody I've been from to, people would understand that. Yet when this early times, this surah of Surah 17 was revealed in the early days of Islam, Quraysh, or the people of Mecca, didn't tell Muhammad, yeah, Muhammad, what is this farthest masjid? What is this sacred mosque? The Arabs understood very well these places where these places were. Okay? So the Aqsa Mosque is not what's in Palestine today. Because if we read few ayat further in the same surah, i.e. Al-Isra 17, exactly on ayah number 7. Allah talking to the children of Israel says something. He says, "In ahsantum ahsantum li anfusikum." If you act rightly, that is for your own good. Wa in asa'tum falaha. But if you do wrong, then it is against yourselves. فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ الْآخِرَةِ. But then, when the promise of the second time will come true, لِيَسُوءُ وُجُوهَكُمْ, that they will defile your faces, i.e. they will defeat you and they will treat you very badly. Allah talking to the children of Israel. And then Allah says, وَلِيَدْخُلُوا الْمَسْجِدَ, and they will enter the masjid as they entered it the first time. وَلِيُتَبِّرُوا مَا عَلَوْا تَتْبِيرًا, and they will utterly destroy all that falls into their power. Allah talking to the children of Israel is telling them that if you do good, it's good for you. But if you do bad, it's against you. Because when the second time for your punishment will come to pass, there will come a strong people who will enter the masjid as they did the first time. The children of Israel, the Jews, they go to the temple of Solomon. But it's not true because historically it doesn't stand. But what Allah is on about here, al-masjid, is Allah is talking about the land. Because the promised land, al-masjid, is the place where you live, where you function. Yes, today we link it to performing a salat, sujood. But it's not that. A sujood is any act of goodness that you do. A salat is part of it. But it's not just the masjid, the mosque. Al-Masjid is called Al-Masjid because we go and perform. Allah in Al-Quran refers to the Masjid as Buyut Allah, But anyhow, so Allah here is saying that it was the deed of Allah to have taken Moses at night from the forbidden land in Egypt, and he took him all the way to the farthest land in Jerusalem, so that Allah shows Musa and of course his people of Allah's miracles. And we all know that Musa saw the miracle of Allah. Allah opened the land, the sea in front of him. Allah fed them out of nothing. Allah had sent clouds to protect them from the heat. Allah gave them water. Allah did everything. So they saw a lot of miracles, and Musa saw a lot of miracles of what Allah created. The first ayah in Surah Al-Isra does not speak about the voyage of Rasulullah from Mecca to Jerusalem, then to the heavens and back, and from Jerusalem to Mecca. It talks about Allah bestowing his favors on the children of Israel. It never was like that. There is another problem with the idea of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. It is common knowledge, my dear sisters and my brothers, between the men of religion, or the scholars if you want to call them, or the sheikhs, whatever, that the arrangement of the surahs of the Quran that we have today, when you go and you open your Quran, you are going to see Al-Fatiha, Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, Al-Nisa, Al-Ma'idah, Al-An'am, Al-A'raf, and so on and so forth, until the end. Okay? So you see the surah one after the other as it is. But this way, the way it is today, is different than how it was revealed. The arrangement of the surahs today is different to the how they were revealed. For example, Al-Fatiha is surah number one in the Quran. When you open the Quran, it's surah number one. But its revelation placement is fifth. I.e. there were four surahs that were revealed before Al-Fatiha. But when Uthman ibn Affan and the people in his time wanted to do the Quran that we have today, they decided to put Al-Fatiha first, and then Al-Baqarah second, and Nisa. And when they were asked, Uthman said, I go with the biggest to the shortest. That's what they, Al-Baqarah, for example, is surah number two in the Quran of today. In its arrangement, placement is number two. But in Revelation, its number is 87th. Meaning 86 surahs were revealed before Al-Baqarah, yet it's placed number two. That's why we have people today that are calling and putting the Quran as it were revealed, not as Uthman did it. But anyhow, Ali Imran is surah number three in the Quran placement today, but in Revelation, the number of 89th, i.e. 88 surahs were revealed before it. An-Nisa in the Quran today is number four in the placement of the book. But in Revelation, it's 92, meaning 91 surahs out of the 114 were revealed before it. Al-Ma'idah is number five in the Quran, but its revelation time is 113th. The last one was Surah At-Tawbah. Surah At-Tawbah is the last one, which in the Mus'haf happens to be surah number nine. This order creates a huge problem for us, because when the sheikh and scholars wanted to prove that Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj happened at the same time, the problem with this is Al-Isra, which is the trip from Mecca to Jerusalem, was mentioned in Surah Al-Isra. However, the ascension from Jerusalem to the heaven was mentioned in Surah Al-Najm. For your information, Surah Al-Isra is surah number 17, but is the 50th surah in Revelation. Yes, in the Quran, its placement is 17th, but in Revelation time, it was the 50th surah, while An-Najm, the number of it in the Quran today is 53, but was 23 in Revelation. What this means is the following. When Allah revealed the Quran, that about the night journey, which happened in the surah that was revealed before the heavens, because the one that says he went from Mecca to Al-Madinah is the 50th, And the one who says it's been from Jerusalem to the heavens is 23rd, meaning in the early days of Islam, Allah spoke about the messenger having made the trip to heaven. Yet, that didn't happen because that surah was revealed in the first year. 9 years later, the trip takes place. So the Quran is talking about something that didn't happen, but he talks about it in the past. And this is a big, big problem. And that's why the contradiction about this invented journey are so big. So when the next time they mention to you the Quran, that, oh, it's in the Quran, and it's there, tell them, no, it is a lie. It never was. About Allah never mentioned the Al-Quran, not from Mecca to Jerusalem, and not from Jerusalem to the heavens or back, and all that kind of thing, not at all. In Surah An-Najm, which number is 53, it's way at the back of the Quran. There is a story, a historical fact that doesn't sit well with the whole Isra and Al-Mi'raj story. It is reported that in the books of history, of course, and the hadith and things like that, they tell us that when the messenger of Allah had enough of the disbelievers of Mecca and their tyranny and how they mistreated him and everything. One day when Allah revealed to him Surah An-Najm, the star, the Surah number 53, the messenger went to the place where the great masters of Quraysh would meet up. That is near Al-Kaaba. So he would go there, and there is a place, and then he found them all together. When he got to them, he started reciting to them the Quran loudly of Surah An-Najm. And remember, Surah An-Najm is 53, which is at the back of the Quran, but revealed way before Allah spoke about the trip from Mecca to Jerusalem. All right? Now, books of history tell us that the messenger of Allah got to the people of Mecca, the disbelievers of Mecca, the great masters of Mecca, and read to them Surah An-Najm. At the end of it, Allah talks to the people of Mecca and he says, "Hada," this, i.e. the Quran that is read to you, the Quran that Muhammad has received, "Nadhirun min an-nudhur al-ula," is an early warner from the very early warnings. "Azifat al-azifa," the imminent, i.e. the end, your end of disbelief of this city of Mecca has neared. "Laysa laha min duni Allahi kashifa," no one besides Allah can uncover it, okay, i.e. take it away and save you from it. "Afa min hadha al-hadithi ta'jabun," is it then, you the disbelievers of Mecca, from this hadith, yes, Allah refers to the Quran as hadith, you seem surprised. "وتضحكون ولا تبكون," and you jokingly laugh and do not weep from the Allah's threats in it. "وأنتم سامدون," and you are entertaining yourselves amongst you, i.e. you're taking the Quran and all the warnings and threats in it so ever lightly, you're joking, you're laughing at it. And then Allah tells them, "فاسجدوا لله," do prostrate to Allah and be subservient to Him, i.e. submit to Him. And this is An-Najm 53 from ayah 56 to 62. The books of hadith tell us that when the messenger of Allah reached the end of the surah, "فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَعْبُدُوا," do prostrate to Allah and be subservient to Him, he prostrated. Guess what? Everyone that was there at that very moment there prostrated because they were scared. Now, the date of this event is reported by the books of hadith and history that it was in year 5 since the beginning of Islam. Pay attention. Al-Mi'raj, or Surah An-Najm, the surah of the star, talks about the messenger going to heaven, which happened in year 10. But this event took place in year 5, meaning the surah, which the sheikhs and everyone else says talks about the journey to heavens, was revealed way before. And this is impossible. Even Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated that when the messenger of Allah prostrated as a result of this ayah, submit to Allah and worship Him, he says that with him, i.e. with the messenger, prostrated the Muslims, the pagans, the jinn, and all mankind, which is nonsense, of course. This one is in Bukhari, Tirmidhi, and it's hadith authentic. So as you can see, how did all mankind prosper? But anyhow, this means that the surah, as I said, An-Najm, which according to the books of hadith and sheikhs and scholars and everybody, was revealed before 5 years. It doesn't make sense. It really doesn't make sense, since Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj took place in year 10, as they said, of course. Again, in small conclusion to this topic here, I would say this. There is an incredible number of books which have been written about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey. Two journeys that never ever took place. Yet, our men of religion keep spreading this lie. And they have spent an incredible amount of ink and time in defending this non-existent fact. Actually, to the point of manipulating the Quran to make it mean what they want. Yet, when we put the historical facts with what's in the Quran, it doesn't work at all. So many different ayat in the Quran negate, reject, refuse the fact that the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, was taken from Mecca to Jerusalem, then from Jerusalem to heaven 7, back again in Mecca. Since Muslims do not read, they do not research, and they only rely on what's told to them, it was back in time very, very easy for the sheikhs to manipulate, lie to them. Back in time, for somebody to read, it was a very far-fetched thing. So people relied on the sheikh because the sheikh could read. People trusted the sheikhs blindly. The sheikh have lied. They have betrayed. They have preached to us something that Allah has in Al-Quran rejected, not one time, not two times, not 100 times, not 200 times, so many times. And I encourage you to listen to the whole talks. If this is, of course, your first time listening to me, please do go back to the previous talks. If I have to count the number of evidences that I have produced to prove that the Isra, that the journey from Mecca to Jerusalem, then from Jerusalem to heaven, back, and then back to Mecca, there could be around the 50, maybe 60, 70 evidences that it never took place. Again, this Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj is just one lie that has been told so many times that people thought and think it's a truth, when in fact it is a lie. I will later on, inshallah, in the next part, speak about the origins of this blasphemous event of Al-Isra and Al-Uruj, i.e. the trip from Mecca to Jerusalem, and from Jerusalem to the seventh heaven. And you will find out that the whole journey is mentioned in the Bible, really in the Bible and in the Torah of the Jews and Christians. And that the idea that Muhammad and what he saw and what he did, when I start reading to you the texts that are in the Old Testament, which is the Bible, the Torah, and then in the New Testament, the Gospel or the Injil of Jesus, you will find that the stories are so similar that all you have to do is just place Muhammad in the tale and he will be about him. So I will stop here and we inshallah carry on in the next installment or the next part about the origins of this blasphemous event from the Bible. Again, this is your brother Abdusalam, and off to part 5. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.